Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger, and we're talking about mathematics and music. I'm actually here in Bali, which is something of a musical place. In a last video, we discussed the distinction between tones and notes. Today I want to talk about the relation with pitch, and also the importance of transposition, and the general orientation of trying to maintain a flexible approach to the framework of music. So, absolute pitches are described in terms of hertz or beats per second, and in the Western world, the standard these days is to peg down the A above middle C, usually called the A440 system. Okay. So that A, which is sometimes described as A4, if we're starting with a notation with the bottom of the piano, working our way up in octaves, that A4 note is given 440. It's pegged at 440 beats per second. With regard to that, middle C will then be a frequency of around 252. And in earlier times, the system was to orient where middle C was. So there was a scientific sort of version or tuning where middle C was given the value of 256, which is conveniently a power of 2, that's 2 to the 8. And then all other C's are going to be also powers of 2, so that's a kind of a convenient system. But currently it's 440 for that A above middle C. So that's the absolute pitch. Now, for a lot of applications, the absolute pitch is really not that crucial. Of course, I mean, it is in terms of tuning instruments and becoming uniform and such. But musically speaking, it's often the relationship between notes which is more important than the absolute notes themselves. So with this in mind, I think I prefer that we think about my proposed system of tones and notes as being a relative one that is determined by first starting with a choice of a frequency as a bass or bass tonic frequency, and then using this tone slash note system as a way of describing other notes with relation to that fixed choice of tonic. So for example, we could start with middle C as I illustrated on the piano in my last video and sort of regard middle C as the note 0/0. But I think we should maintain flexibility so that, for example, in some other system, we might choose some other note and regard it as the bass note 0/0, and then everything else is going to be correspondingly determined in terms of that. So one reason for doing that is because in music, when we look at a band or an orchestra, there are often instruments playing which are in different keys. Okay, this is maybe not so appreciated by keyboard players, where we're always in sort of C mode. So many instruments, trumpet, trombone, saxophone, clarinet, French horn, are going to be in a different system with respect to their fundamental key. So let me explain that. So I used to play saxophone in a band. In fact, I used to play alto saxophone in one band and baritone saxophone in another. And those are both E-flat instruments. Now, what does that mean? Well, it means that if I see a C note on a staff, okay, so if we're using the usual treble clef staff, you know, with 5 lines, then that bottom open note is an F, and then the next one is an A, that's the 440A, and the next one is a C. So if I look at that note on that page, I'm going to play a C. But somebody who's playing the piano is going to hear not a C, but rather an E flat. That's why the alto saxophone is called an E flat instrument. And it turns out that the baritone sax is also an E-flat, but it's one octave down. But for example, a tenor saxophone is a B-flat instrument, meaning that when the tenor saxophone player plays that same looking note, that looks like a C to them, they are going to play a note which is heard as a B-flat on a keyboard. And similarly, trumpets these days are mostly B-flat instruments. Clarinets are B-flat instruments. The French horn is a bit of an exception. It's an F instrument. So for various historical reasons, these alternate systems of sort of keys of instruments are really ingrained in our musical culture. And in fact, there's actually a good reason for it, so it's not entirely illogical. You see, if you're in the saxophone playing community, sometimes you play alto sax, or as I have, play baritone, and maybe switch from alto to tenor, or maybe to soprano sax, which is also a B-flat instrument. So what you want then is that the same skills of reading music are easily transferable, because physically the keys on these various saxophones are much the same. So we want the situation that when you see a C note on a staff, like one there, that all the saxophone players are going to use the same fingering positions for that. And if you think about it for a second, well, that means that the actual instruments themselves are tuned in different ways, because of course the bigger instruments are going to produce lower notes. So it makes sense that when a tenor saxophone plays a C, it sounds different from when an alto saxophone plays a C. And so that means that if you're writing music and you have a score and you want to include an alto saxophone and a tenor saxophone or a trumpet or a clarinet, you have to adjust, you have to transpose the music accordingly. So for example, suppose you've written a piece of music in the key of C and you want one part to be played by an alto saxophone. Okay, so you recognize this line here is going to be played by the sax. Okay, so that means you have to transpose what you've written, because basically you end up having to go down from the C to A, because if the saxophone plays what appears to them an A, then you will hear it as a C. So if you want them to play a C, you have to write an A for them. So because the relation between a C and an A is the same as between an E-flat and a C, namely a step of 1, 2, 3, okay? So three steps, transposition is required to rewrite that piece of music for an alto saxophone. So we can see that because this problem is repeated, because there's lots of different instruments, that the technique of transposing is an inherently, really hugely important technique for composers and arrangers of music. That's just a consequence of the physical way we have a variety of instruments. So in mathematics, when we're looking, say, at the number line, I was describing before in our last video, you know, the distinction between emphasizing the translation symmetry of the number line with a reflection symmetry about zero. So when we're talking about numbers, there's a good case to be made for both of those points of view. So I'm not saying that the translation point of view is superior. I'm just saying that there are these two points of view, and both of them are really worth thinking about. In music, the corresponding words, instead of translation and reflection, are transposition and usually inversion, okay? So transposition is, generally speaking, a more important concept, a more important technique in music than inversion. Inversion does play a role, and it's important, but not as important in transposition for a number of reasons. One is just what I've suggested in terms of compatibility between different instruments, but another is simply to wanting to take a piece of music and to move it up or move it down, because perhaps it's a vocal piece and you've got a great soprano, so you can bump it up a little bit and make those high notes even more spectacular, or you know move it down for a tenor or whatever. So there's various reasons for wanting to transpose pieces of music. So that translation invariance is really important, and so that's why I want to think about this notational system. It should be one that facilitates transposition, that makes it a little bit easier for us to overcome the natural hurdles and challenges in moving from one key to another. So a closely related sort of issue here, which we're going to have to talk at length about, is the actual physical notation that we use for reading music on a page, our staff notation. You'll all mostly know that, you know, standard, let's say, piano score will have a line of five, the treble clef, and there's another line of five, the bass clef, and, you know, roughly corresponding to right hand and left hand playing. And then various instruments are written either for the treble clef or for the bass clef. Typically, bass instruments like a tuba or euphonium will be bass clef, and the woodwinds and so on will be treble clef. But then we also have stringed instruments for which the situation is more complicated because there are other clefs as well. So there's an entire discussion to be had about what kind of useful system should we have or could we consider in terms of notating music, putting music on a page. And so the current notation that I'm introducing for tones and notes, I'm wanting us to think about that as a preliminary step to being able to think about the issues of writing down music on a page in a nice way. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.